During the Buddha's time, a woman went into labor and began to give birth to a son. However, on that night, the stars aligned in a particularly ominous pattern. The boy's father discussed this with the wise Brahmin and learned that the stars were aligned in what was known as the Bandit's Constellation. The child born on this day would bring great distress and hardship to the area in which he lived through his criminal actions. The boy's father took his son to the king and said, "My lord, I have a responsibility to inform you that my son was born during the Bandit's Constellation last night. He is prophesied to become a great bandit and create great distress and hardship for his family, his city, and his country." With great emotion, the father offered his son to the king and said, "My lord, if you deem it appropriate, please give the command to kill this doomed child for the good of our land and people." The king, after thinking for a moment, said, "My good man, how can we prematurely kill this baby, who has yet to do wrong, based on a prophecy or constellation? Nay, raise him well, and hopefully he will grow to be a good person." The boy was named Satuka, and every attempt to raise him with an internal moral compass was futile. When Satuka played with other children, he would often steal from them. When Satuka became an adult, he committed many prolific crimes which led to his capture. After he was apprehended, he was paraded through the town by the soldiers. Bhadda, a young woman who happened to be born on the same day as Satuka, heard the commotion and looked out of her window. When she saw Satuka, it was love at first sight. Something in her heart drew her to him. As she watched him being paraded through the town, she could not take her eyes off him. She envisioned a blissful life with him. Her imagination led her to the determination that she could not live without him. All that she knew was that she was in love. She had her servant inform her parents that unless they found a way to free Satuka, she would refuse to eat or even continue living. Her mother and father tried their best to reason with her. Being in love with such a bandit would bring embarrassment, danger, and other disadvantages. They offered to find her a suitable husband, but Bhadda would not hear of it. She turned her back to them and refused to listen to anything they had to say. With this, Bhadda's father bribed the guards to free Satuka. Bhadda's parents then arranged Satuka and Bhadda's wedding and gave many of their belongings to Satuka. Although Satuka was happy to be freed from his execution, domestic life did not sit well with him. He missed the thrill of stealing and of taking that which others desired to keep. He yearned for the taste of accomplishment from seizing the belongings that others so desperately wished to protect. Although everything in the house was basically his heart felt unsatisfied. Satuka devised a plan and told Bhadda, "My love, there is something very important that I need you to help me with. Before your father freed me, I made a vow to a mountain deity. I said that if he helped me escape my execution, I would make an offering to him. I must honor my vow, or else our family will be cursed with bad luck. I must travel to the mountain and make a grand offering to the mountain deity in order to maintain the auspicious future we have ahead of us. I need you to come with me. Please wear all of your finest jewelry to show the utmost respect and gratitude to the mountain deity. Bhadda, blinded by her love and lust for Satuka, was excited to join him on this journey. Bhadda adorned herself in all of her most expensive finery. All she could think about was their blessed future together. She allowed her imagination to block her wisdom. Satuka took Bhadda to the robber's cliff and brought her to the edge. Bhadda was ecstatic to be with her husband. When they arrived, Satuka aggressively snatched Bhadda's jewelry. Satuka then said, "Foolish woman, why would I want to live a domestic life with you? I am a robber, a bandit. That is my path. I will kill you and go live a comfortable life alone with the money I can make by selling your jewelry." "My love, what are you saying? My money, my jewelry, my body, and my heart are all yours. Why do you need to kill me? Why do you need to steal from me? It is all already yours." Bhadda saw the murderous intent in Satuka's eyes and realized her grim future. Instead of feeling sorry for herself or becoming angry at Satuka, she used her wisdom to focus on her survival. She thought, "I have been born with a brain and wisdom. Will I allow myself to perish without having used them? What good is my wisdom if I don't use it to save my life?" Bhadda then said, "My husband, my master, it will be as you wish. I am willing to let you push me off this cliff. But before you do, please let me perform my last obeisance from the four directions to you before I die." Satuka then said, "I am happy that you accept your fate, since there is nothing you can do about it. I will accept your obeisance." Bhadda then approached him from the front and embraced him. She said, "My love, this shall be the last time that I see you, and that you see me." Then she kissed him. She then approached him from the left and embraced him. She said, "My love, after today, we will never again get to be together." Then she kissed him. She then approached him from the right and embraced him. She said, "I have loved you since I first laid eyes on you, but we shall never meet again." Then she kissed him. She then went behind him and embraced him from the back. She then thought, "This man means to kill me. I am not ready to die. I must do what I must do to protect my life." She then whispered, "I loved you with all my heart." Bhadda then pushed him with all her might. Satuka, taken completely by surprise, fell forward and over the cliff's edge to his death. The burden of her evil action caused Bhadda to fall into shock. She thought, "I have murdered my husband with my own two hands. How can I return home? My parents will be disappointed in me. I forced them to let me marry this man. And now I will return home after having killed him? They will never understand. They will never accept me at home. I have brought massive shame onto the family name." Thinking this, Bhadda decided she had no choice but to run away and start a new life on her own. Bhadda decided she did not want to return to a layperson's life. She no longer had interest in sensual pleasures and possessions. she felt the weight of her evil karma and feared the repercussions that were sure to follow. Bhadda decided to become a wandering ascetic. She joined an order of chains. As penance for her evil deed, Bhadda underwent a violent ritual in which her hair was torn out by the roots before she could ordain. After some time, Bhadda's hair regrew and was very curly. Therefore, she was known as Bhadda of the curly hair, or Bhadda Kundalakesa. As a chain nun, Bhadda was very kind and compassionate. The memory of her evil actions drove her to repent for her sins. She spent her time diligently practicing the chain way of thinking. However, in Bhadda's mind, there were many things that the teachings were not able to clarify. She did not feel that the teachings were enough to free her from samsara, the repetitive cycle of rebirths. Bhadda was not shy with her concerns. She studied all the teachings the group had to offer. When she found them incomplete, Bhadda asked the leading nuns about her reservations. Whatever the nuns explained, Bhadda was able to debate them and expose the flaws in their teachings. Bhadda left that group and joined another. She studied all of its scriptures and teachings. However, the same thing happened. She was unsatisfied with the teachings and won debate after debate with the teachers, exposing the teachings as incomplete. Bhadda continued to do this until she felt there was no one left that could show her the way to enlightenment and the freedom from suffering she so desperately required. Bhadda began to go to large cities and build small sand piles. She would then proclaim that people with wisdom should stomp on her sand pile to show intention to debate her. If someone were to win, she would marry him and serve him for the rest of her life. If the person who won was a monk, she would become his student. Many people initially tried to debate Bhadda, but Bhadda had joined so many groups and studied so many teachings that she had a wealth of technical knowledge to use as ammunition in her debates. She was also very wise and skilled in the art of debate. She gained a reputation as an unbeatable debater. One day, the Venerable Sariputta, the foremost in wisdom of all the Buddha's followers, saw Bhadda erecting her sand pile. He asked some children what Bhadda was doing. When he heard that she was interested in debating, he had the children stomp on the pile. Bhadda scolded them for stomping on her pile without the intention of debating. The children explained that the elder Sariputta had instructed them to. Bhadda was delighted that she had another debate partner. She was certain of her victory since she had become used to winning every debate. She asked the elder a great number of questions, all of which the elder answered clearly, concisely, and eloquently. Then the Venerable Sariputta questioned her, saying, "What is the one?" Bhadda thought about it long and hard, but was not able to come up with a suitable answer. She was sure he didn't mean God or Brahma. She was stumped. She admitted her defeat and begged him to be her teacher and refuge. The Venerable Sariputta told her that she should take the Buddha as her refuge, and then proceeded to bring her to the Chaitavana temple. When the Buddha saw her, he knew that her spiritual karma and paramitas were ripe enough for her to reach enlightenment. While she was still walking to him, the Buddha said, "Though one might be able to recite 100 verses, all are mere useless words. Much better is the single word of the Dhamma that upon hearing it, one finds true peace. Upon hearing just this short verse, Bhadda penetrated the Dhamma fully and became an Arahant right in front of the Buddha. Her spiritual journey and search for salvation had finally come to an end. She then ordained and entered the order of Bhikkhunis. The Buddha proclaimed her as the foremost among all Bhikkhunis who attained Arahantship faster than anyone else.
What did you learn from this story? We hope you enjoyed the video. Click like if you did, and click subscribe if you want to see our uploads.